ॐ सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यङ्करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्तिश्शान्तिश्शान्तिः। In the last class, we saw up till verse number 10. And the purport of the verses 5 to 10 in the fifth chapter tell us something very, very important. They talk to us about the importance and the salience of Karma Yoga, that without Karma Yoga, there is no jnanam. So we saw that there is the lifestyle called Karma Yoga and a lifestyle called sannyasa. And without being equipped by the maturity, the emotional maturity that Karma Yoga gives, one cannot adopt a lifestyle called sannyasa. Sannyasastu mahabaho dukkham aptum ayogatah. Without yoga, sannyasa is very, very difficult, impossible to have as a lifestyle. Often in the mind, there is a confusion between the lifestyles, and one equates atmajnanam with the lifestyle of sannyasa. This, as we have seen in the previous classes, is not always true. One can be a sannyasi without atmajnanam, and we have seen that as well. And one can be a karma yogi and gain atmajnanam while in grihasthashrama. And this is something which Gita emphasizes, Lord Krishna emphasizes a lot, because when we look at a goal, especially a goal that is not away from ourselves, if there is a goal away from one, then you have to reach it. Then you have to decide, how am I going to reach it? What means am I going to go to this goal? So if it is a place, then you can decide, am I going by foot, padayatra, am I going by car, by train, by plane, that is possible. But for a goal which is centered on oneself, which is in fact oneself, then how do you go? Where is the going? There is no going. And that is what has to be known. It is something to know, not something to go. And this is the mistake that is made, because one thinks one has to go. The orientation is towards doing, towards moving, towards constantly being engaged in activity. We call that spinning the wheels of the buddhi, of the mind, of the karmendriyas, of the sense organs. It's like keeping on moving without going anywhere, even mentally. Even spiritually, keep on going without growing. And so therefore, since the human orientation is towards the product, everybody is product oriented. What is the end product? That is what everybody wants. And how to get there quickly? That is what one wants. And Lord Krishna changes the course of the spiritual quest by making it process oriented, by highlighting the fact that it has to be something. The spiritual goal called moksha is not product oriented. It is process oriented. What's the difference? Something that is product oriented, I have to go quickly, I assume that the product is away from me, and then I have to find out how to get it, and then go get it, and then do some efforts, make some efforts to retain that if it is something I want. And again, it involves a lot of ayasa, physical, mental, emotional, exhaustion, effort. And we have seen in not only in the Bhagavad Gita but also in the Mundaka Upanishad that this goal is not centered on action. Action binds, knowledge frees. This we have to keep on understanding, because this is something that one loses in the course of the study of the Bhagavad Gita, being a long text divided into chapters. This thing, the fact that moksha is not product oriented, the pursuit of moksha is a process oriented quest rather than a product oriented quest, must be understood properly. Because if that is not understood, then the whole Gita is as good as wasted. You can listen, but nothing will happen. So whenever some quest is product oriented, then it has as the main sadhana action. Because if it is a product, then it is an object. And if it is an object, I can hold it, grasp it, see it. But what about Atma? It's not a product. Product means that which is put together. And logic shows us this. We don't even need Shastra for this. Logic tells us that whatever is put together, what happens to it? It falls apart. Anything that is put together falls apart. Do I want a moksha that is falling apart? No. The answer, of course, is no. Why? Because when I come to the spiritual quest, I am already falling apart. I need something to pick me up. I need a body of knowledge that will pick me up from constantly falling apart. Being blown about by the winds of samsara. This is how the student in the text called the Viveka Chudamani approaches the teacher. Durvara samsara davagni taptam dodhuya manam duradrishtavataihi bhitam prapannam paripahi mrityo. Like this, he approaches the teacher. I don't see any other refuge than you. Hey Guru, Durvara samsara davagni taptam. I am being assailed by the hot and the foul and hot winds of samsara. The toxic winds of samsara, and the hot and toxic winds of samsara are encircling me and giving me great distress. Dodhuyamanam, we have a frequentative and intensive usage with a suffix called yang. So, dodhuyamanam, repeatedly being shaken about. By what? Duradrishtavataihi, by the winds of papa, bad karma. So, the winds of bad karma are repeatedly shaking me. Bhitam prapannam, therefore I have become a permanently frightened being. I have gained fear as my constant companion. Paripahi mrityoho, save me from mortality, save me from this daily death of succumbing to samsara. This is the thing. This is how the student approaches the teacher in a beautiful text, which I hope you will study someday, called Viveka Chudamani. Now, here, when the student approaches the teacher, the student talks about his, her inner makeup. Meaning what? I'm falling apart. If I'm falling apart, my goal should be not to fall apart. My goal should be to seek something that keeps me together. If my nature were to constantly fall apart, then it would not be a cause of botheration. But I know, even without the study of Vedanta, this is not me. That's why everybody will tell you, I don't quite feel like myself these days. And samsara, you don't quite feel like yourself at any time. This is the samsara roga, bhava roga, the disease of wanting to become something, something, something or the other. And so, if I am falling apart, the goal for which my eyes and my mind is set on should be something that makes me not fall apart. And if the falling apart can be cancelled by action, then we have to see that it won't take us far. So if I can patch myself together, put one bandage here, put one bandage on the head, put one bandage somewhere, and so that I'm not, put one bandage on the sad heart, put one bandage on the frightened heart, and then I'm together again. This, if I feel that this is the way I experience in life, my own life experiences should tell me that that is not the case at all. That is not the case. Why? Because I have been there and done that. I have marshaled all the things, all the means at my behest, at my service. I have used up every single karma to not fall apart, to be put together. In other words, the one who falls apart constantly, ayukta. The one who is together, yukta. So this is exactly why we need karma yoga. This is exactly what the discussion is. This is the crux of the fifth chapter. This is exactly why it is important. Because karma is finite. Result of karma is finite. So if I have stopped myself from falling apart today, definitely by the end of the day, what will happen? I will fall apart. Even through all the various pujas, you can pray to not fall apart. And then again, the karma phala of prayer will be again finite. You can pray for security. And then again, that will be finite. You can pray for wealth. You can pray for all your desires to be fulfilled. But that does not stop one from falling apart. Showing the non-connection between the pursuits of arthakama and a sense of well-being, which is moksha. A sense of liberation, which is moksha. A sense of freedom from longing, from want, from kama, krodha, all these things, which is moksha. And so we see that karma cannot lead to moksha. I don't need a big Upanishad to tell me this. The Upanishad will tell me this. The Bhagavad Gita will tell me this, practically in every chapter. But even without that, one knows why. One has been there and done that. So therefore, the habitual orientation to have a product-oriented approach, quest, pursuit must be retired. Put it on a pension. Retire it completely. Give it some retirement package and let it go. Just say, you are no longer in service. Thank you for your services. I have to hire something, somebody else new. I cannot rely on you anymore. So the product-oriented quest can only take us so far, and the analysis of the product-oriented quest leads one to understand that since the end is centered on me, the goal is myself. The wayfarer, the seeker is myself. Sadhaka, seeker, myself. Sadhya, goal. Who is that? Myself alone. So it's all about me, 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 me. That's why the analysis of the Shastra is called Mimamsa, because it's all about me. And so if everything is centered on me, then there is no product to talk about that I can get, that I can reach, that I can pluck from a tree like a ripe mango. There is no product to talk about because the Atma is not a product. Atma is that which, because of which I can interact with all the products. It is that consciousness because of which I can interact with all products itself is not a product. Go back to Mundaka, which talks about the nature of the I as not an object of sight, adrekshyam agrahyam, not something to be objectified. Avarnam, no color. Agotram, no lineage. Achakshushrotram, no hands, no eyes, no ears, no sense organs. Neither does it have sense organs, nor can the sense organs objectify it. Then apanipadam, no legs, no hands, no parts. No parts, which is wonderful, which is why I will not fall apart. When I understand Atma without parts, I will not fall apart. So therefore, the quest has now taken a U-turn. How do you spell U-turn? Y-O-U. The turn where the goal is you. And who is the one who is turning? You. So now the quest has taken a U-turn from looking for products everywhere to satisfy so many things. What do? I make this quest a process-oriented quest. And what is the process here? The process is discovering myself from being the one who is always falling apart to understanding that I am the one who does not fall apart. This is Karma Yoga. The Karma Yoga leads me to the discovery that there is something that is intact and I can discover this being through some simple sadhana, through some simple practices, very simple everyday practices, which we saw in the third chapter, the five types of yajnas, Atithi Yajna, the honoring the guest, Bhuta Yajna, honoring all the beings, Deva Yajna, worship, Pitru Yajna, awareness and giving to ancestors, Manushya Yajna. Like this, we saw all the various yajnas. And this yajna is my participation in the world, which finally converts the world as samsara to the world just as a benign entity, not a malignant, toxic entity. This is where the scales of subjectivity drop from the eyes because of Karma Yoga. So the process-oriented quest is called Karma Yoga. The product-oriented quest is just karma. There is no yoga there. And there is no person who comes out called Yukta. And then in the 10th verse, we have also seen how dedicating the actions to Bhagavan, Brahmani, Brahma here, Brahman here is Ishvara. Brahmani Adhaya Karmani. Sangam tyaktva karoti yah lipyatena sapapena padmapatram ivambhasa. One is protected from papa. Karma Yoga has many, many, many advantages. It keeps you in your lane. You don't go into other people's lanes. While you're driving, if you go into the next lane where there is the traffic is coming from the opposite direction, definitely the car will become chutney. Here, no such worries. You keep to your lane, you do what you're supposed to do, and everybody follows what they are supposed to do. And so, dedicating the actions to Bhagavan, and so therefore, not being totally obsessed with the results of action, one is as pure as a lotus leaf, which does not attract water, which does not do this. And so therefore, this is where what we have seen up till now, and going further, The next verse is very beautiful, the next set of verses. So we will see now verse number 11. And verse number 11 talks about the, again, unfolding the attitude of how the karma is done by the karma yogis and what is the motivation for the karma yogi to do karma. Because if I am a karma yogi, then why will I do karma? Because karma does not lead to moksha. But then why will I do karma? Karma directly does not lead to moksha. Indirectly, it definitely prepares one for moksha. It is an indirect auxiliary sadhana for getting ready for jnanam. And so this is what is talked about from verses 11 to 13. Let us look. Kayena manasa buddhya kevalairindriyairapi yoginah karma kurvanti sangantyaktvatma shuddhaye. So the Atma Shuddhaye, fourth case, Atma Shuddhaye, for the sake of Antahkarana Shuddhi, for the sake of Antahkarana Shuddhi. Antahkarana means mind, emotions, for the sake of growing up the mind and the emotions, for the sake of purification of Antahkarana, Antah, inner. Karana, instrument. That includes mind, buddhi, chittam, ahankar. All these are included. And they are all beset by, they all have ragadveshitis. They are all sick with the presence of ragadvesha and their friends, kama, krodha, etc. So then, how to make a sick mind well? Put it on a diet of karma yoga. Yoginaha karma kurvanti. It's not that the yogis just sit in one place and they don't do karma. Because not doing karma is also, it's both not possible and dangerous. So therefore the karma is dedicated to Ishvara and whatever comes is accepted as prasada. And so yoginaha karma kurvanti. This is an important verse. The karma yogis perform karma. Why? For the sake of Atma Shuddhi. Atma here is not Atma. Atma doesn't need to be purified. Atma is already ever pure. Nitya Shuddha Buddha Mukta Atma. This is Adi Shankara's favorite phrase. So always pure. Nitya Shuddha. Nitya Buddha. Always of the nature of knowledge. Always pure. Always all knowledge. And Nitya Mukta, always free. So the Atma is not the problem. What is the problem? Anatma, thinking itself to be Atma. That is the problem. So the mind, this Jiva, invested, equipped with the body, mind, sense complex, thinking oneself to be sad, thinking oneself to be not free, this is the problem. And so therefore, what is needed is to alter that thinking. And we saw in the last verse, altering the thinking requires an altar of surrender. That's why it's called altar. That Bhagavan, that altar called Bhagavan, which is the altar of surrendering all my actions, including the notion I am the actor, has the power to alter the mind from being a sad individual burdened by kartritvam, holding a big basket of doership. I'm finally able to let that at the feet of the Lord. We saw that. And so the actions done for the sake of gaining this shuddhi, freedom from the hold of ragadveshas. Again, we are not trying to remove the ragadveshas. We are trying to not be under their hold. We are trying to dethrone them from being the master of the heart to an able and a willing servant. That is what we are trying to do. A very reliable servant, we are trying to make them do it. And so therefore what? Yoginaha karma kurvanti, very straightforward sentence. The yogis perform action. How? Sangam tyaktva. Karma sangam tyaktva. Karma phala sangam tyaktva. Karma phala asakti is not there. So I am not the doer. This understanding is there. So karma sangha. So I am not obsessed with this action. I can let go of doership because Bhagavan is here. Bhagavan is the doer. I am just an instrument. And then karma sangam tyaktva, and then karma phala sakti, the karma phala is also the penchant for producing results of action, even though it's not in my hands, that is also happily and nicely given up. That is very nicely given up. So sangam tyaktva, karma sangam tyaktva, karma phala sakti, you know, that phala saktim tyaktva. Tyaktva means having given up. Yoginah karma kurvanti. But are they out of the mind, these yogis? Are they mad? Why would you give up the results of action when they are the best thing about action? The best thing about action is something I will get at the end of this. No, they are not mad. In fact, it is the desire for the results of action and being obsessed with the results of action is what makes one mad. The karma yogis are the sanest things on the planet, the sanest people on the planet, because they do karma consciously. Why? How? For the sake of Atma Shuddhi. Atma here, the Antahkarana. For the sake of Antahkarana Shuddhi, for the sake of ridding the mind of strong ragadveshas. So that is the last line. The first line talks about how do they do karma. Kayena, physical action is included here. Manasa, mental action is there. And then buddhya, using the intellect. So the yogis, without being obsessed by the results of action, karma yogis perform the action for the sake of purity with the body, mind, intellect and sense organs without identifying with all of them. That's why we saw earlier Pashyan, Shrinvan, Swapan, Shvasan, all this is there. And then this is the idea. So kevalaihi means just for the sake of, with the help of various organs. Kevalaihi is important here. Kevalaihi means kevalaihi means for the sake, only for the sake of Atma Shuddhi. Atma Shuddhi means for the sake of growing up, for the sake of becoming an emotionally mature, mentally together, and a person who is free of arrogance, free of disappointments, free of frustration. This is what we mean by a process-oriented quest. Every action has in its, you know, in as a kernel, arrogance. Because I can say, oh, I did it. Pride can come, arrogance can come. And why did you do it? Because Bhagavan, this is what it is. You have gifted the actions to Bhagavan. So whatever comes is a prasada. And so therefore, arrogance, and then if success comes, pride comes. If the action leads to failure, disappointment comes on the other side. So even when we succeed or when we fail, Lord Krishna says that is the key here. That it's a gift from the Lord. It's a gift from the Lord. And it was already talked about in the third chapter, the 30th verse, the person of Karma Yoga, Nirashihi Nirmamo Bhutva Yudhyasva. Arjuna was told to start this war. Get up, fight. How? Nirashihi Bhutva. Give up the identification with the doer. Nirashihi. And the outcome of the action, don't worry about that, because that's not in your hands. Nirmamo bhutva, this is not my war, this is not me, this is Bhagavan. Do this. And then vigatajvaro bhava, he was told, lose this ragadveshaitis by taking recourse to karma yoga. And again, sangam tyaktva means what? Without anxiety about the future. Oh my God, everything is centered on this one action. If this one action does not go well, then everything will fall apart. It will not. It will not fall apart. You think it will fall apart, but it will not fall apart. But this is the feeling that, if I don't do this one thing, this one exam, this one interview, this one thing, my whole life is hinging on this one person, namely the boss who is not giving me my promotion, or this one person with whom I'm obsessed. People are like that. If this person doesn't become my friend, that means what? I'm falling apart. And if this person I cannot marry, then I will fall apart. All these are what? In the head. In the head. This shows karma sakti, you know, the karma asakti. Asakti for the karma itself. Asakti means involvement, attachment. And karma phala sakti also it shows that already I am ahead of myself. Here again, from being a process oriented person, I have jumped to the product. When there is karma sakti, I have jumped to the product. When there is karma phala sakti, I am definitely in the future. I am not in the present. I am again product oriented, and the product being finite, finite means what? That which appears to be really fine in the beginning, and then what? Finite. Then you understand that as you're holding at it, as you're looking at it, it is falling apart. It is totally falling apart. There is a beautiful story that is told in the Zen Buddhist tradition. So there was a Zen master, and One Shishya comes to him, and the Shishya has got him a present, like a, you know, something to take to the Guru. There is a saying in it all comes from our Shastra only. Riktapanir napashyet rajanam daivatam gurum. Three kinds of people should not be seen empty handed. Who are there? Raja. Raja means the ruler. Now we have no ruler, we have netas, leaders. So even if you didn't vote for them, and if they come to your house or if you go see them, you have to carry something. Doesn't have to be a big thing, some fruits, flowers, whatever it is. And then it's the gesture, it's not the how much money you have spent on that gift. Then Rajanam Daivatam, if you go to a place of worship, you don't go empty handed. Even if you don't have anything, you put some money in that little box which is there, called hundi. Then finally, Guru. Guru also, you don't see anybody. You do not see who is a teacher. You don't see empty handed. When you go to see the teacher, you go with the, you take something. So riktapanir napashyet rajanam daivatam gurum. So three kinds of people must not be seen empty handed. And then so here the Zen, so therefore succumbing, you know, following that tradition, the Zen student, the disciple, took a beautiful bone china cup for the master to have his tea. So here he thought it will be so nice. It had some nice hand paintings, very thin, beautiful. That's why it's called bone china. Like the bone is subject, bones are subject to a disease called osteoporosis. As one grows older, one falls apart, the bones fall apart. And so this bone china is also subjected to that, perhaps falling apart. So that's why it is a very delicate, very thin cup. And so he took that. It had a nice lid. He thought my master can have some nice tea with it. And so it was nicely wrapped. And from the wrapping, you could see this. And so he gave the master the cup. Very happy and proud. Oh, I have got the best gift. Nobody else has this wonderful gift. And the master saw that and said, "Yeah, it is very nice, but unfortunately, it is broken." And the Shishya was filled with dread. Ayyo, how did this happen? I was so careful in selecting, and I was so determined to select the correct thing. How did this happen? How did this break? No, I should not allow it to break. I should do this. I should let me see. And he took it from the master. He opened it from the box and the packaging. Looked at everywhere. Looked down. Looked this way. Looked that way. Looked at the handle carefully. And then he said, "No, master, it is not broken. Please accept this." And the master took it again in his hand and said, "It is broken," and put it on the table again. And the Shishya looked at it again and said, "No, master, it is not broken." And this went on for two, three times. And then it occurred to the Shishya, he was getting a Zen lesson right then and there. The cup was not broken, but the future of the cup is what? Broken. It is finite. Karma phala is finite. No matter how fine it is finite. The only thing that is not finite is the truth of the one who is saying it is finite, namely myself. And that's why the product-oriented quest leaves one tottering in disappointment. And yeah, therefore, the Sangha, putting all the things in one basket, and this marriage is the key. Home, building a house is the key. Having this job is the key. And if I have a child, this is the key. Everything will be okay. This is called Karma Phala Sangha. Holding this one particular thing as the key to my success, the key to my sanity. So therefore here, Sangam Tyaktva means without any anxiety towards the future. That is the main salient feature of Karma Yoga. No tension, no stress, nothing. And nowadays, what do we do? We'll have all the stress we want and then sign up for a yoga retreat. Destination yoga retreat somewhere in Cancun, some island somewhere. And then you see these photos and these videos of people doing yoga on the plank in front of the beach. And then when do you need this yoga on the beach? In between the stress. That's why it's called beach. Beach, beach mein yoga karo. Beach in Hindi means in between. In between stress. So I can pay thousands of dollars and go for some retreat. I'm not saying don't go for the retreat, but understand that that's not going to relieve the stress permanently. Without spending the money, with Karma Yoga, you can be stress-free instantly if you decide to see that you are that this quest is not product-oriented, it's process-oriented, it is centered on you, not on what you can get out of it. And so therefore, Atma Shuddhi, understanding this means Atma Shuddhi, Chitta Shuddhi. Showing that, seeing that this Chaitanya Rupa Atma I am, and I don't need any cleaning. The Atma doesn't need to be clean. So what is there? What is there to be cleansed? What is there to be cleansed is my motives for doing action. Is the feeling that I have to do this, I have to get this, and all this. So therefore, the karma yogis practice this for Atma Shuddhi. And why do I need Atma Shuddhi? I need Atma Shuddhi for Atma Jnanam. Again, quoting the Viveka Chudamani, what does Adi Shankara say this is a text that is attributed to Adi Shankara. Chittasya Shuddhaye Karma Natu Vastu Palabdhaye. Chittasya Shuddhaye Karma Natu Vastu Palabdhaye. Vastu Siddhir Vicharena Nakinchit Karma Koti Bhihi. Ato vicharah kartavyah. This is how it goes, it unfolds. Chittasya shuddhaye karma. Action is performed for the sake of chitta shuddhi. Chitta shuddhi is what is called in this verse as atma shuddhi. Chittasya shuddhaye karma natu vastu upalabdhaye. Not to gain the atma. Chitta shuddhi. So karma does not allow you to gain the atma, because karma is finite, the product of karma also finite, limited, atma limitless. By the limited actions, the limited atma can never be gained. So therefore, natu vastu palabdhaye. How is the vastu? Vastu means the only thing being worthy of being called a thing. In the shastra is atma. Everything else is nothing, nothing. And so, chittasya shuddhaye karma natu vastu upalabdhaye. So how do I get the vastu? Vastu siddhihi, the gain of the vastu as the truth of myself, vicharena. Vichara means what? Vicharena, through enquiry. This is atmajnanam, through enquiry. This is what we are doing right now. This is what is called atmajnanam, through self-enquiry, through self-knowledge. Nakinchit karma koti bhihi. Even if you do crores and crores of karma, the vastu will always be away from you. That is the idea. Next one, going further. Karma phalam tyaktva shantim apnoti naishthikim ayuktah kamakarena phale sakto nibadhyate. Here, to emphasize the points that we have been making further, Lord Krishna here, the teacher, says the following, draws up a contrast between the one who is yukta. Yukta means what? Together, not falling apart. There is a mental strength because of karma yoga. There is an emotional togetherness because of karma yoga. There is an emotional strength, a mental strength. The person is not anybody, anytime somebody says foo, blows, the person does not fall apart. The person has tremendous strength in the face of adversity, in the face of challenges. Pujya Swamiji used to always say, the strength of a person, how did it go? The human being is like a tea bag. I am like a tea bag? How is a human being like a tea bag? The strength of the person is evident when he or she is put in hot water. So when you put tea bag in hot water, how strong the tea is, you can see, because it will give that color of the tea will go into the hot water. So similarly, when the person is put in hot water, namely challenging circumstances, then only the strength of the person becomes evident. Because if everything is going according to how I want, the strength, there is no test of strength. Karma yoga, remaining in the grihastha ashrama or in any ashrama and doing the work, etc., allows me to build up the strength. This is what is said. And so, yuktaha, the person who is together as a result of karma yoga, what does the person do? Karma phalam tyaktva, giving up the karma phala, shantim apnoti, attains peace. What kind of peace? Naishthikim. Naishtiki means born of nishtha, commitment. Nishtha is commitment. Nitaram sthitihi is equal to nishtha. Nitaram sthitihi means that in which one stays for a long time. That means it's a committed lifestyle. Taking on karma yoga not for a day. Okay, I'm practicing karma yoga for 2 hours. No, not for a day. But then for what? For a long time. Practicing karma yoga for a long time as a committed pursuit. Then shantim apnoti naishtikim shantim. So that which is born of this nishtha, that which is born of this committed lifestyle, naishtikim shantim apnoti. The person gains a kind of a shanti, unshakable shanti. The shanti that is born of the discipline of karma yoga, and that shanti is connected to what? Karma phala tyaga. The repeated refusal to take on the result of action as my own. The repeated refusal to be product oriented. And the product oriented means being oriented towards the result of action. And that being a reason for my karma. This is what is called a product oriented life. Where has that got us? Nowhere. And so, yuktaha karma phalam tyaktva, renouncing the result of action, shantim apnoti. Ap to gain, apnoti, to gains the peace, gains the, attains this shanti, which is absence of disturbance and the presence of a sense of well-being within oneself, gains this peace. And what is this peace connected to? The peace is a direct offspring, the direct result of this committed pursuit and ripening as a karma yogi. One's maturity as a karma yogi is the cause of this peace. The committed pursuit of karma yoga is the cause of this peace. Whereas ayuktaha, the one who is product oriented, kamakarena, due to the presence of kama. Due to the kamakaraha means the kama is the karta. The kama is the karta here. The kama is so strong, the ragadveshas become the karta and drag me behind them. And they are going at 100 miles per hour. What will happen to poor me being dragged on the road? They don't care. I want moksha. They don't care. Too late, they said. Because this is what it is. Once we nurture this kama, krodha, raga, dvesha, they become monsters. Like even Frankenstein. There is a story that somebody created this robot to be somebody he could order around. But the robot went rogue, and that robot's name was Frankenstein. And that Frankenstein threatened to kill the master. This is what happens. I lose mastery over raga dvesha as long as I'm leading a product oriented life. And so therefore, to regain the mastery, I have to become committed to karma yoga. Otherwise, what happens? Kama karena. Kama is the karta here, the undisciplined ayuktaha, the person who is always falling apart. What happens? Phale saktaha. So the asakti is in the phala, attached to the result, due to being driven by desire. Being driven by desire, nibadhyate is bound to the, a very important verse, another very beautiful and important verse. So is bound to the products of action and their result. No peace of mind. So karma yoga gives peace of mind. The question may arise here. Once we have understood the, I hope you have understood the translation. So we have seen all the words. Yes. So, tyaktva karma phalam, renouncing the result of action, yuktaha, the person of karma yoga, gains the peace born of of the discipline of karma yoga itself, whereas the ayukta, the product oriented person, falls apart being driven by the impulse of karma and karma phala. This much we have seen. Now a question may arise after looking at this verse. Jnanam, atma jnanam also gives peace of mind. Karma yoga also gives peace of mind. Is there a difference? That is the thing. Is there a difference between karma yoga and what? And atma jnanam. Atma jnanam gives peace of mind. Karma yoga also gives peace of mind. So if I get peace of mind through karma yoga, then why should I pursue jnanam? Like this, many people are there. So many people are there who say, why should I pursue atma jnanam if I'm already getting, I'm leading an ethical life, they will say. I am fine. I'm leading an extremely ethical life. I don't need anything. I am a moral person. I'm just doing my job and then I'm okay. Why should I pursue atma jnanam? Why should I go to the teacher? Why should I come to you? I'm fine as I am. Don't disturb me. Here is the rub. So naishthikim shanti, shantim. So the shanti is, that is discipline, that is based on the discipline of the lifestyle called karma yoga, is different from atma jnanam. And what is the difference? This shanti from karma yoga is like, you know, like let's say one is, you know, some unfortunately there is an accident on the road. And you know, the head is struck because the vehicle came to a sudden, had to come to a sudden stop. Thankfully no major injuries, but the head is struck, it is bleeding. What do you have to do? What one has to do is administer some bandage. First aid, it is called. First aid means what? Then the second aid should be there. The person should be evaluated in the hospital. Cat scan, dog scan, whatever it is, PET scan. I don't know why it is called CAT scan and PET scan. There must be some acronym. So anyhow, so they see all that has to be done to make sure there is no concussion. The brain, it is not bleeding. So first they will move the finger in front of the eyes. Are you okay? Can you follow the finger? Left to right, right to left. Okay. Are you following simple commands? Raise the hand up, put it down. Yes. Okay. Then let us do one test to make sure that there is no bleeding or swelling in the brain. That is second aid. Second aid is more important than first aid. First aid is enough to just to get you to the hospital. That's why it's called first aid. So this relative shanti, this relative shanti, which is the prasada of karma yoga, is what? It takes you to, not hospital, takes you to atma jnanam. You can say it's kind of a hospital for one who has samsara roga, where the teacher is Bhagavan, really, because all this knowledge comes from Bhagavan. All this knowledge comes from Lord Dakshinamurti. So the teacher is, as I had said previously, Bhava Roga Bhishak. The teacher is the vaidya, the doctor. And so therefore what? So therefore this is the atyantika shanti. This knowledge gives atyantika shanti, immense and intense shanti from which there is no return. This is how, if you remember the 72nd verse of the second chapter closed. Esha brahmi sthitif partha nainam prapya vimuhyati sthitva syam antakalepi brahma nirvanam richati. Antakalepi sthitva brahma nirvanam richati. This is shanti. If this shanti is not going to go away, once you understand the truth of this this I as not the karta, not the bhokta, not the doer, not the one who is done in by one's own or other people's actions, then one is equipped with this. It's just so amazing, so beautiful. So then this shanti here is like the first aid administered at the site of the accident. Whether it's some kind of an industrial accident, road accident, immediately some first responders will come. And then after that, what? it will take the person in an ambulance with the sirens. No traffic, nothing. Straight away one can go to the hospital for the main treatment. And that is Atmajnanam. That is Atmajnanam. No roadblocks, nothing, free passage. And the person is stabilized by Karma Yoga, and the person who is stabilized by Karma Yoga, not constantly falling apart, is enjoying a relative cheerfulness. That's another meaning of Shanti, is the person is not always in the doldrums, you know, like this. Once or twice, yes, you know, sometimes when, you know, one is having a difficult moment or a difficult day. But if you're all the time like this, then this Karma Yoga is for you. Definitely. There is no better pick me up than Karma Yoga. Done all the time, of course. Not just 1 minute of Karma Yoga and let me see if my Shanti muscle has developed. No, that will not happen. I can write it down, seal, sign and deliver this paper. On stamp paper, I can write it. Once a day Karma Yoga. No, this has to be my committed lifestyle. What is the proof? Array, the proof is in the pudding. You eat the pudding, that is the proof. So the person was given the pudding and rice pudding. How do I know it tastes good? Array, taste it and see. Then only you will know. No, but I want to be assured it tastes good. No, even Bhagavan cannot come and assure you of that. Bhagavan says, I have given you a tongue and then I have given you some brains. Last time I checked, I gave you some brains. Now use your brains and make that use your, employ your tongue and then you will know how it tastes. This is how it is. So the Karma Yoga is in the application of it. But we want what? We want beforehand, we want some, what is that, guarantees and warranties. Even when you buy a costly appliance like the laptop I'm sitting in front of to talk to you. Even when you buy one costly appliance, there is only 1 year guarantee. My dears, there's only 1 year guarantee. Karma Yoga gives lifelong guarantee, prepares you for a shanti that is unshakable. And you have, the proof is in the practice, in a committed practice. You know, you can't just let it go and then say, oh, I tried Karma Yoga for 3 minutes and then, you know, I became pessimistic. No, this is, you have to give Karma Yoga a chance. And besides, you see some people are, you know, cheerful. It's not that, you know, they don't have difficulties in life. It's not that you have been targeted for difficulties and they are going scot-free. Everybody, if they are born on this earth, they have karma, very difficult karma. But what you make of the karma can make one into a saint. A Karma Yogi is saintly, saint-like, because it's not because they've had an easy life, far from the truth. It's because they have been able to convert these difficulties by the dint of hard work and being dedicated to Bhagavan. They have been able to convert these difficulties into what? Into a kind of a shanti born of discipline. Shanti, presence of well-being. Shanti, absence of being disturbed by any kind of difficulties. Shanti, presence of cheerfulness. You know, that is a lightness of being, a lightness in the mind, in the heart. That is shanti. This shanti is the promise of Karma Yoga. Tell me who won't want to do Karma Yoga after this. Yeah, you know, this is how it is. This is how Lord Krishna teaches. So then the next line says, whereas ayuktaha kamakarena phale saktaha nibadhyate. The ayuktaha is what? The one who is always falling apart, even though there is karma yoga, the one who does not take recourse to karma yoga, such a person is shackled by what? Their own kama, their own krodha, and shackled by the results of action, shackled by this sad, sick, product-oriented life, searching for a product which the Atma is not, searching for the I as a product, which is the saddest thing on the planet. Kamakara, and the kamakara means the one who is driven by kama. You know, our culture is so beautiful. The child being initiated into Gayatri mantra, the first mantra, when the child is taken for upanayanam, taken to the Veda, the initiation into the mantra, in that ceremony the child is told to say, kamah karta naham karta kamah karayita naham karayita. Kama made me do this. And desire made me do this. This is a 9-year-old child. I mean, the beauty of this culture is mind-boggling. How spiritual it is. And it is told in a way that an 8-year-old, 9-year-old can understand. I am not the doer. Anger made me do this. Krodah karta, manyuh akarta, manyuh karta. Manyuh karta. Kamah karta, manyu means anger. Anger made me do this. Desire made me do this. I am not the doer. The child is repeating this from age 8 onwards. Every year. It's just amazing. And so, ayuktaha, the one who doesn't understand this, by the force of the karma, is shackled. Nibadhyate, is shackled into this wheel of product. And then the end product not being satisfactory, more karma, more product, and all these useless products. That is what one is. Continuing. Sarva karmani manasa sanyasyaste sukham vashi navadvare pure dehi naiva kurvanna karayan. Sarva karmani, all the karmas. All the karmas, kaya, vaja, manasa, everything, you know, manasa sanyasya, mentally giving up, the karma yogi, and here the one who is a jnani is described, the karma yoga has now fructified into atma jnanam because of the preparation and the pursuit of the self-knowledge, preparation karma yoga, pursuit jnana yoga. Here, because of the preparation and the pursuit, manasa sarva karmani sanyasya, giving up all the actions mentally, sukham aste, vashi, the person who is a master, the master of the self, sits down happily. Who is the master of the self? Dehi, not the deha. Dehin, the one who is the indweller of the deha, the one who, as I like to say, is in the deha. And what is this person? Navadvare pure dehi. In this deha, the one who is the master of this nine doors and windows, the nine gated city. Nine gated city, yes, the body with all its orifices, and we'll see what they are. And then navadvare pure dehi naiva kurvan, neither doing nor making other people do. And this is the translation. More we shall see in the next class. Om purnamadah purnamidam purnat purnamudachyate पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते. ओम शांति शांति शांति. हरिः ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः. हरिः ओम. थैंक यू.